Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we're praying for Katrina. Katrina, Tony's daughter, right? We're lifting her up in the name of Jesus. We're praying also for Minerva, who's in the hospital right now. We're lifting her to the Lord for healing on her kidneys. Yvonne, we're lifting up your father-in-law, Joseph, in the name of Jesus, for his health, his passage to heaven. May the Lord be with him. And Father, we just ask, Lord, that you would just move in his life, Father, that you would appear to him in the power of your Spirit, Lord. And we pray for Irma, peace at work. And Father, we're lifting up the Toledo family. Father, we just ask now, Father, for a blessing, strength, comfort upon the Toledo family. And Father, today, that as we come before you, Lord, I ask, Father, that you would just steal our minds, bring calmness, bring peace, bring, God, your presence into our very hearts. And Lord, I come against every foul, wicked, evil, lying, tormenting, deceiving, unclean spirit, Lord, that would harass, torment. And Father, we just ask for the blessing of God. Give us hearing ears today. Give us seeing eyes. Give us an understanding heart to be able to take in your word. And Father, we just thank you for this opportunity. In Jesus' mighty name. And everyone said amen. Praise God. All right, praise God. You can be seated. Praise God. Welcome, everybody. We're so glad that you're with us. And hopefully I'm not blessing the heck out of everybody. Let's see. Let me turn it up to do it more. Now. All right. How are we doing? All right? Praise God. Just had to make a little adjustment. I'm missing Fred right about now. Freddie, my techie. I usually like to mess with him during the service. And of course, how could I forget, hermana, we're so glad, Rosemary, that your mama is up and moving. Whew, man. She's a walking miracle. She really is a walking miracle. And sis, we're praying in the name of Jesus just for God's presence, God's healing upon you in the name of Jesus. And so, anyways, you know, take a look at the board up there. Let's see if it comes up. Oh, wait a minute. I got to share it. Boom, here's my notes today. And I hope it makes sense to you, because to me, it tells me everything I need to know. Now let's go home. This is crazy because, you know, I was sharing Annette with my wife last night. I said, "Hun, man, when I'm in the Word of God, I get these images, and man, in my head, boom, I start doing all this stuff." And for me, what this tells me is God the Father, God the Son, bringing love, life into the world. And at the same time, it's a little diagram telling us what happened through Adam and Eve giving birth to Cain and Abel, and how death came into the world. Are you good with it? Yeah. All right, good. Now let's go home. No. And then, so I try to interpret it even more. I went into how God moved on the earth and how he moved through Abram. He was known as Abram before Abram, or Abram before he was known as Abraham. Now, the reason that's so powerful is because that's where God said, boom, he's going to move on the earth. So after my issues that I was having, thank you, Annette, she added order to my notes. Lot better. So today, you guys, I just want to I want us to go to some verses of scripture today because my message today is, and I think I called it a world of love and hate. A world of love and hate and God's plan. Because you know that we really do live in a world of love and hate. There's a lot of hate in this world. You know, sometimes you wouldn't even realize how much people will be haters. I don't know if you ever had those encounters. Like, the more that you engage in the world with your worldview and looking at the world as through the lens of what God has done and is doing in our life, sometimes you're going to be hated for it. It's interesting because Jesus said, in the world, you shall be, what's that word? Hated. Jesus said it. Jesus said, in the world, you shall be hated. But and then he also said this, if they hated me, come on, somebody, look up them verses, man. Help me out here. I'm giving you Bible. For those of you that are Bible nerds, boom, bam, bring it out. Scream it out. That's the book of John. Come on, what happened? How many Bible nerds we got here? Well, what was that? John 15, 7. Very good. Oh, 17? Okay, I can't even hear, so. But Jesus said this, in the world, you'll be hated. And he said, if they hated me, this is Jesus. Jesus. Can you hate Jesus? Right? People hate Jesus. I know here it's easy to say, oh no. Santo, 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 no, never, never, I will never hate Jesus. But Jesus said, if they hate me, if they hate me, they're going to hate you. Now, we really have to stop and believe what Jesus said. Because sometimes we read these, we go to church, we hear the word, we read scripture and all that, and we just read, oh, if they hate Jesus, they're going to hate me too. And act like people don't hate them. They will hate you. They will not only disagree with you, but it's possible that they may harm you. It's possible that they will do you wrong. One of the first cases that we see in the movement of Jesus, that when as he was preaching, as he was teaching, you know, they hated Jesus. And why did they hate? Why is there so much hate toward the Lord? Because he spoke the truth. Because he brought the truth of God's word. Because he was literally saying, when you see me and what you see me doing, I'm taking that which the Father, what I see of the Father and what I see him doing and saying, I'm doing all that. And he was hated for that. Isn't that something? Maybe we could relate to it like this. How many times have you been hated on because you were doing something good? Or how many times you were hated on because you took the right path. And maybe sometimes even in your own home, your own family, that can happen. It's interesting that Jesus even says that you know, that when he comes, he brings a sword. That family members will hate each other. Did you ever read that? And look at it in the sense like, Lord, what are you talking about? God is love. Right? But yet, that's the reality. Because of all this hate. And so this diagram that I was sharing with you earlier is what we see in this diagram here is in Genesis 1:26 through 28. And you can just write it down because I'm going to go through this fast. And that is in the beginning, God said, and in the beginning, God, you know, created, right? We know that God is the creator. That'd be one circle, right? But then the thing is that God said, let us make man in our image. So in the image or in the likeness of God, he created man. That's why you see God and then a blue line going across, Son of God. God, Son of God equals life. I was telling my wife, I said, hon, what I'm trying to create is a genogram. I'm not one of those educated guys, but I hung around a lot of MSWs, social workers, all that, with interns and all this. I hung around with USC, UCLA, this, that, Northridge, all this stuff. And that's a big deal for me. I don't know if I told you that I got to go speak at USC. Did I tell you? Did I tell you? Yay! A dude from Pacoima, who was a dropout. See, that's one of the things, you know, I dropped out. I almost made it through San Fernando High. My problem was I would get too loaded and me and my girlfriend would jump the fence and head out. We bounced and it wasn't a net. But I'm just saying, so it's amazing to me that I got the opportunity to speak at USC. And those that are going after not only MSWs, but they have some that are going after their law degree and different things they're doing. And so one of the things that I've learned, the reason I said all that is not to give a bragamony, because only God can do something like that. Only God can do something like that, take somebody, drop out, don't know anything. As a little kid, I still remember, just hoping, I hope they don't call me. They better not call me to answer that question. And sitting there, like, I know what it feels like to feel like the dumbest kid in class and hope that they don't call you to answer that question. I know what it's like also to have to go to speech class and sit in a specialized class and sit there and sweet Sally sells seashells near the seashore. Anybody else take that? Oh, you're pretty good. Anyways, you're pretty good. Oh shoot, I'm really messing up everything. and the reason I'm saying that is, I said all that is because as I'm talking about this genogram, one of the things I found out or learned about genograms is it really takes a circle. As you see that circle, it goes across. It's usually, it would be God and the Son of God. And then when you look at God, and then it goes down to Adam and Eve, you see that blue line going down, and then you see the red lines. Those red lines represent something broken. In this language of genograms, because what you're looking for is areas of strength and support. You're looking for areas of brokenness, things that happen, a wedge that have come into homes or families or a person's life that really impacted them in a crazy way. That's why when you see that red lines there, from God, remember we said in the beginning, God and the Son of God, God said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness. And then boom, he created Adam. And you know what's crazy? I was thinking about what Graham looked like from Adam to Eve. Because usually the way that it goes, for example, when you think about it is, this genogram would reflect, for example, here's me, circle, here's Annette. So usually there's a line like that. And when there's a divorce, that red line, boom, 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 the brokenness. But on that blue line, a line would drop down, and on that line would be Joshua. Right? And then on that line, on the bottom circle, would be Joshua with another line going to Priscilla. Boom. Bam. Right? And then from those two lines would drop down four lines. Angelina, Josiah, Noah, Nevaeh. But anytime there's a brokenness, anytime there's something that breaks in that genogram, you're reflecting that red line. Now, the reason that it gets complicated sometimes is because I've seen these genograms where it just gets really crazy, man. You got one circle after another circle, and then another broken line. You got all these crazy circles, and boom, all of it filtering into generations. Hello, does that make sense? All right, good. The reason I went there with it was because I reflected Annette and I, you know, that circle. But it's amazing that when it comes to God and then Adam, you know, you would think that, wait a minute, Adam needs to get a female so he could create that. No, instead he takes out from within the rib of man and he makes Eve. So it's kind of like he disrupts that flow, because everybody else that comes to planet Earth has this. Your mama, your daddy, your mama, boom, came together, and all of those, like with my mom, my dad, 7. Then after my dad died, there would be a circle, a different mark representing death, and then another man. And from that one, another brother would come out of that. And then out of that, an adoption. And boom, so our circle, it just gets pretty amazing. So I wanted to look at for a minute, one of the things that I'm really focused on today is that last line, Adam, Eve, and then they had Cain, and then Abel, and what did they produce? Death. Death. Now, the reason this is valuable or so important to us is because when you talk about that death that came as a result of what Cain did to Abel, he murdered him, he killed him, he hated his brother. For the first time we see introduced, for the first time ever we see introduced, the second time that we see this brokenness happen is as a result of the brokenness with God. What is the next thing we see produce? Hate, murder, envy, jealousy. And I want us to go over to the book of Genesis. Let's look at that for a minute. Genesis chapter 4, and then I'm going to jump into something else here. But Genesis chapter 4, and I want us just to really take time to look at that. How did that happen from Adam to, that the way the Bible puts it is, it says, and Adam knew his wife Eve, and they bore, knew. You ever trip out on that word when he says knew? Yeah. Why? Known of all kinds of people. But the verbiage, literally, that he knew means that he had intercourse. That's why, I don't know if you trip out or not, when you first read the Bible, the first time you ever read King James, because I'm a King James fanatic usually, but when you read that, and Adam knew Eve, and they bore. Like, you know, we don't talk like that today. Hey, guess what? My cousin just had a baby. Yeah, he knew his wife. Well, we're going to say, I thought he always knew her. Okay, that didn't go over too good. So let's go ahead and read this in Genesis 4. Look at verse, and this is, I'm going to be reading from the New American Standard, the 2020 translation of it. One of the things that this Bible does, and some Bibles do it, number one, you have to remember the King James, the king that gave the authorization to translate the Bible into the common language of their day, King James, is that they use a lot of that vernacular to take. Of course, a lot of scholars came together and took the whole idea while they're breaking down the Aramaic, the Hebrew, the Greek, and they're taking all of that and boom, translating it into what we commonly know as the King James, right? But this book here also takes, I don't know how many times that there's books that we read and look at, that it took hundreds of scholars coming together and man, just like boom, 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 boom. I mean, just putting it all and tying it all together, trying to give us thought per thought or word per word of what they're saying. And that's why, like, some people have issues with the Bible. And that's because mainly they just don't understand that piece of it. Isn't that right? What the heck? I guess I went blank for a little while. But notice this. Now the man, verse 1, so this is the translation I'm reading, the New American Standard Bible. The first edition was 1995. This edition is 2020. And here's how they read it, or how they framed it. Now the man had relations with his wife. Oh, you like that better? Instead of he knew. Yeah. Hey, I knew Annette back in 19, what was that? We figured it out. 1981 of December. Okay, sorry. Never mind. Now the man had relations with his wife Eve, and she conceived and gave birth to Cain. Now check him out, Cain. You got anybody named Cain? Okay, good. I thought we had to pray over him. And she said, I have attained a male child with the help of the Lord. Pretty interesting, if you ask me. Well, maybe, I guess some of us could use help from the Lord on that. And again, she gave birth to his brother, Abel. So here you go. Cain and Abel. Now, Abel was a keeper of the flock, but Cain was a cultivator of the ground. Let me ask you a question. What is it that we remember from Genesis 3 about the ground after the fall, after the disobedience? The ground is cursed. That's why a lot of times when you read scripture and you're going into it, so I think it's important for us to recognize that. Because at one time, don't forget, they got driven out from the Garden of Eden, right? And they got driven out of the Garden of Eden. And the Garden of Eden was what? Very, very fruitful. That's why in this day and age that we live in, it's about really the world dominance and all that. Really, world domination is about taking over, controlling the most cultivative land. If I can frame it like that. Land that is fruitful. Land that boom, you just drop a seed and push. Oh my God. Very fertile, right? I remember when we first moved to Sylmar, we had sold our house over on Tonopah, Sun Valley. We moved out of the ghetto. No, I'm just kidding. We're back in the ghetto. But I remember when we first landed in Sylmar, the lady that we bought our house from, her husband had died, had retired from the phone company, and she was she was one of those gardeners. You know, they had a gardening club. I guess that's what you do when you retire, right? And man, it just seemed like, I mean, she had beautiful bird of paradise in the backyard. There's all these roses and all that. And man, on the side where there's just a little bit of dirt and all that, we had a little tomato patch that thing, I wouldn't even put water on it, and it's kicking out tomatoes. And man, it was beautiful. Till we moved in. But that was so fertile, right? It just grew. So the point I'm making is this. Like when we read this, you're looking at Cain and you're looking at Abel. Cain chooses to go, he's a tiller of the land. He's a tiller of the ground. And I think it's very notable that we need to keep that, put it in our mind, keep that, shelf that in your mind, as they're gonna come and try to offer up an offering to God. And it's important because one is based on you know. And before I say this, is one is based on, because don't forget, they're not that far from that disruption that happened, that breakage that took place where Adam and Eve had fallen. And they know, you know, I'm sure that Adam and Eve spoke to Cain, spoke to Abel, told them the story, rehearsed over and over, maybe while they were eating and stuff, and told them about how it used to be. And it wasn't that long ago. It used to be like this. At one time, God would appear in the garden. We would hear his voice. In the cool of the day, the Lord would just show up. But we got tempted. We got deceived. We got lured. We got lured away. This broken, those red lines I told you about. And I'm sure that they told their sons about the story. That is so important, you guys, for us to share our stories, you know, of God and moving in our lives is so critical. And that's what really they had done. So I just wanted to bring that to your attention as we're reading this, because I don't know, this is what, when I'm in the scripture and all that, man, that's the kind of stuff that happens. That's why, you know, when you've seen that diagram, all craziness, before Annette helped me out, that's what happens in my head when I'm reading scriptures, because I start tying all this stuff. I start grabbing from all kinds of verses, boom, because it's the same story being told over and over. And it's so important. So notice that Abel, again, so we know that, as I said, Abel was a keeper of flocks. And it's interesting that he mentioning what the younger brother's doing first. I don't know. Because I think when you talk to parents, sometimes they want to talk about the most, boom, let me showcase this. And boom, they'll talk about some good. Sometimes either that or the person that's always causing pain, grief. Oh my God, let me tell you about them. And I think for whatever reason now, Abel is being mentioned first. And again, he gave birth to his brother Abel, and Abel was a keeper of the flock, but Cain was a cultivator of the ground. Verse 3, and it came about in the course of time that Cain brought an offering to the Lord from the fruit of the ground. Verse 4, Genesis 4:4, Abel on his part also brought an offering from the firstborn of his flock and from their fat portions. And the Lord had regard for his offering, but for Cain and his offering, he had no regard. So Cain became what? Very, this one's translation is very angry. And his face was gloomy. What did yours say?
Downcast,
gloomy, saddened. But think of this, anger, all of a sudden anger is introduced. You know, I've never read anywhere where Adam is angry at Eve. Have you? I've never read anything like that. You know, because he could have said, man, you ate us out of house and home. You messed up. She could have said, you too, boy. You messed up. I used to have a little philosophy of this, that Adam, I really feel that Adam took a restorative position. When his wife got deceived and ate of that fruit, he was standing right next to her. And at that moment, rather than just like, you're on your own, you did it, you messed up, you made your bed, now lay in it, he didn't do that. I see him also as restorative in the sense that he knows that God will not forsake them and abandon them, even though they've committed this atrocity. And he partook of it, knowing that, boom, together, this is just me reading more into that story, that together they would face God together. I see him as redemptive. I see Adam that, you know, don't forget that his job was he gave names to all the animals. His job was to cultivate the land, do all this. And yet this relationship with God, this relationship, I always wonder, if that relationship with God didn't speak to his heart and say, God will never leave you nor forsake you, even though you've messed up, even though you've sinned, even though you've fallen down to the bottom of the barrel, God is gonna move in your life regardless of you being at the bottom of the barrel. And that's why when you read Genesis 3, and when you get a chance to just look at it, dissect it, and really take a good look at it, when God is saying his redemptive plan is etched, as he's saying to the woman, And of course, the thing that passed on Adam, and of course, the serpent cursed. And then, of course, the slave labor, just the crazy things, Adam, that you're going to go through now. But to the woman, the enmity that will pass between your womb, your seed, and talking about, that's where God's plan comes in. To bruise the head of the serpent. Talking about future, that through that womb that a child will be born that will bruise the head of that serpent. It's important for us to understand how that God moves in those situations. So notice this. So that's why I take a little detour. But as we read this, we're going to read one more scripture, and then we'll head toward closing. Closing number one. So it came about in the course of time. Look at verse 3. I think we read that. Verse 4, and Abel on his part also borrowed an offering from the firstborn of his flock, from the fat portions. And the Lord had regard for Abel and his offering. Verse 5, but Cain, his offering, he had no regard. So Cain became angry. That's where we took off that anger, that crazy, uncontrollable anger that turns into hate and murder. Jealousy, hate, and murder. So Cain became very angry. Look at verse 6. And the Lord said to Cain, why are you angry? You ever have God ask you that? Why are you angry? Well, Lord. Oh, I'm not, sorry, hon, I'm not pointing at you. Look, when you do, why are you angry? Well, you know, but what a great question. The world is angry. There's so much anger. There's so much hate. I mean, all bundled up. It's crazy. Sometimes I think I'm too tapped into the world in the sense of being in so many social platforms and this and that. I'm not saying I'm on Facebook all day long. What I'm saying is that I have so many different, every day I get hundreds of emails. I'm on neighborhood, I'm on different emails, I'm on different things. And different news broadcasts, you know, that I'm subscribed to and all this. So, I mean, every day I get to hear, like, just all the craziness and, like, I can't believe it. I can't believe how much anger and how much of that is bundled up and how much we see happening around here. And this is where it came in. That's why when I'm sharing this diagram with you is that death that we see there, this thing with Cain, this anger that is there, that why are you so angry? What does anger look like? It looks like uncontrolled emotions. It looks like anger at its peak, where it becomes violent. It becomes destructive. Anger gets, when it reaches its peak, it has no regard for anyone or anything. Anger at maximize, at its highest output, is crazy. This anger is so violent. This anger has no limitations. That's why, like, we need to pray for our kids. They live around this infestation of anger that is rooted and grounded in this very spirit of what I'm talking about here. Now I do gotta tell you, there is a scripture that says, be angry and what?
Sin.
And sin not. There's a difference. There's a difference. That's a different thing. Where, of course, hey, man, I'm going to get upset. I'm going to get angry over this. That's different. Man, you know what? It's a different ball game when you begin to talk about that. Be angry and sin not. Don't. And then that's why he even tells you, don't let the sun go down on your wrath. And what else does he add to it? Give the devil no place. Ephesians. So what he's saying, I seen this little cartoon character thing there. It had this couple, and they've been up for 4 days. Because they weren't going to let the sun go down on their anger, their wrath. Don't let the sun go down on your wrath, your anger. So they're like this 4 days. but it's interesting that Ephesians will actually tell you and give the devil no place, because it is possible that some of those things, you know, they could start out just a little bit, and then if you don't watch out and manage it and get controlled by the Spirit, allow God to transform the way we respond, to transform the way that, you know, the old me, my old nature that constantly would try to, like, just boom, and, you know, and just respond just like that. And that's why in this verse here, it's a great question. Why are you so angry? Why is your face gloomy? If you do well, will your face not be cheerful? And if you do it well, and if you do not well, listen to that. This is powerful in verse 7. And if you do not do well, sin is lurking at the door, and his desire is to have you. But you must master it. Now, that's one of the things that this what I'm talking about, this this thing that has come into the world that became very detrimental to the human spirit and to our society, to our you know, humanity, is this spirit that the Lord is saying to him, hey, if you're doing well, hey, right on. But if you're not doing well, sin is just lurking at the door, and his desire is to have you. But you must master it. Can we master this anger? Can we master this hate? Can we master this thing? Absolutely. Jesus mastered it. Look at verse 8. Cain talked to his brother Abel, and it happened when they were in the field that Cain, and don't forget, God is just putting them in check even before he kills. Right? You're put in check before you kill. This is God working on somebody. I remember years ago in the 80s, the Lord had put us on a path of an individual. And I remember that, boom, God brought him across my path. He brought him across. This is San Francisco, the Mission District, on the Mission Street, 24th and Mission. And I still remember, because we were always sharing the gospel. And then there were some others also in our church that ran across them. And boom, I think it was within a week and a half, he committed a double homicide. And his face was all over the news. Wanted, murder, double homicide. And man, I mean, it's all over the news. And as crazy as it sounds, thank you, Lord, for those bells. Give us peace. Especially as we talk about this murder spirit. But as we're watching all this, one Sunday morning I get up to speak. Right on my left, the same guy, his face is all over the news. Makeup over the tattoos. You know what I feel that really what's happening is that God, just like you're seeing here in Genesis 4, that God is speaking to Cain, that you can control that. There's, you know, if you're doing well, then don't worry about it. When you're not doing well, then sin is at the door, trying to take advantage and capitalize on your anger to get it to the place where, man, full blown, leading into murder. Look at this, and we're just about, those are the bells telling me, like, hurry up, Rudy. Here we go. What verse are we at? Okay, let's go to 9. Oh, let's go to 8. 8. And Cain talked to his brother Abel. And it happened when they were in the field that Cain rose up against his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, where is Abel your brother? And he said, man, I don't know. Am I my brother's keeper? And he said, what have you done? The voice, check this out. Underline this. I challenge you to underline this verse. And just look all over the place where he talks about the power of the blood speaking out. Just you know, go on a rabbit trail and just check it out. And he says, what have you done? You know, the voice of your brother's blood is crying out to me from the ground. Now you are cursed from the ground, which has opened his mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you cultivate the ground, it will no longer yield its strength to you. You will be a wanderer and a drifter on the earth. Verse 13, Cain said to the Lord, "My punishment is too great to endure. Behold, you have driven me this day from the face of the ground, and I will be hidden from your face, and I will be a wanderer and a drifter on earth, and whosoever finds me will kill me." So the Lord said to him, "Therefore, whoever kills Cain, vengeance will be taken on him seven times as much." Whew, heavy duty. And the Lord placed a mark on Cain. Interesting, underline that word mark, a mark on Cain. You know, because you always hear Christians, "Oh my God, you're going to get the mark." There's the first sign. And what's it placed on? It's on somebody that is hateful, murderous, and destructive. That's where the mark is placed. I know we got all kinds of teachings, philosophies, and all that about the mark and all this stuff. But I'm telling you, as we're looking at this, God places a mark on him. And what happens? And he put the mark on Cain so that the one finding him, a mark on Cain so that no one finding him would kill him. And Cain left the presence of the Lord, and he settled in the land of Nod, east of Eden. Cain had relations with his wife, and she conceived and gave birth to Enoch. And Cain built a city. How'd you like to live in that city? You think it's a crazy city? You think it's a city of killers? And he named, and Cain built a city and named the city of Enoch, the city Enoch, after the name of his son. Now to Enoch was born Irad. Irad fathered Mehujael. Mehujael fathered Mahushael. And Mahushael fathered Lamech. Lamech took two wives for himself. Oh, I guess one wasn't enough. The name of the one was Adad. The name of the other was Zilhad. And Adad gave birth to Jabel, and he was the father of those who live in tents and have livestock. His brother's name was Jubal, and he was the father of all who play the lyre and the flute. As for Zilat, she also gave birth to Bocain, the forger of all implements of bronze and iron, and the sister Tubal Cain was Namal, Lamol, and his wife Adal, and so forth. Listen to my voice, you wives of Lamech. Pay attention to my words, for I have killed a man for wounding me and a boy for striking me. If Cain is avenged seven times, Lamech 70 times seven. Adam had relations with his wife again, and she gave birth to a son and named him Seth. And she said, "God has appointed me another child in place of Abel, because Cain killed him." To Seth, a son was born and named him Enoch. Then people began to call upon the name of the Lord. You notice how that through pain and suffering and all that, they began to call on the name of the Lord. As we close off, because I think I'm already going too long, we'll have to pick it up another day, another time. Because one of the things you'll find out that stuck out in my head as I'm reading this is where Cain landed. They also began to, I believe he said, they began to form brass. What verse was that? Brass. And come on, somebody help me out. Bronze and iron. They begin to form or implements of bronze and irons. For the first time, you see them begin to form weapons. Weapons, tools, implements could be used for two things. One of them could be used as a tool, a weapon, or an implement, I should say, for farming, cultivating. The other side of the coin, it could be used for weapons to begin to cause more destruction. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Oh, Lord, help us out today. Amen. Come on, you receive today. Well, next time we're on this, we're gonna go ahead and tackle this here, because later on you're gonna see that in the beginning God breathed life into man. Now He brought life in Jesus Christ, and when you begin to read these verses of Scripture, it just begins to say how that in the midst of death, in the midst of hate, in the midst of all that stuff, God brings His love to the world. And 1 John 4 really showcases that and just picks up on the same thing that you find in the Gospel of John 3:16. And then later on, we're going to see also where in 1 John 4, in other verses of Scripture, where He begins to say that, you know, that you cannot love God and hate your brother. Because, and then He'll even tell us that we should not be as Cain, who murdered his brother. Amen. Let's stand, let's pray. God bless you guys, man. I really appreciate you guys hanging in there. Whew, I don't know how long I went. An hour. Híjole, frijoles. Was it worth it, you guys? I'm just trying to share the gospel, share the word, and stick to Scripture as much as possible. And so, Father, today, Lord, I just pray, as you lift your hands to the Lord, I bless you now, all of you that are here. I speak the blessing of God, the peace of God that surpasses all understanding. We lift you up. In Jesus' name, we pray the power of the Lord upon you, the blessing of God. And Lord, I pray that you will smash and stamp out every foul, evil spirit, Lord, that comes, that lingers, that lurks about, trying to deceive, to torment, to disrupt, God, what you're doing in our lives. And Father, I pray that now in Jesus' name. And Lord, we're lifting up Shalim, we're lifting you up. Thank you for joining us today. Minerva, we're lifting you up. George Martinez, we're praying for you. Mary, and for all that are joining us in Jesus' name. And also, Lord, I pray the blessing of God upon your people. And Father, as they give, as they honor you, Lord, I pray, Lord, that you will bless their seeds that they sow into the preaching, the teaching of the Word of God. And I ask, Father, now that you would bless them. We bless you, Toledo family, for your support. Thank you so much in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. What I'd like to do, you guys, I'm going to play one last song, and I'm going to dedicate this song to the Toledos. I found this nice version of He Ain't Heavy, He's My Brother. This one, I won't get dinged on it, because it's not like the original. So, all right, God bless you guys, and have a good Sunday. God bless.
Many a winding turn that was aware.
All right, if you want prayer, we'll lay hands on you, we'll pray.
But I'm strong.